here today anyway. So I am so glad to be back. 1 month of being in church on the month of July or June was a bit much. I'm glad to be home. And I plan to be home for most of the rest of the summer. So are you guys ready to worship?
Yeah.
Well, let's stand and sing them in, because we got a crowd to bring in. They're over in at the highways and byways, I guess. We got to bring them in.
He has traveled.
welcome you to the house of the Lord. Are you glad to be here today?
Amen.
Amen. Hey, I want to start off right this morning. It is an incredible, incredible Independence Day weekend. And I'm going to ask all of our veterans if they would stand right now. We want to celebrate your lives and the incredible thing you have done for us. Veterans, stand. Who are still seated that did not stand, that those of you who did have a very special place in our hearts.
Amen.
Because this morning we have freedom. We can be here in Salina, Kansas on a Sunday morning, and we don't have to worry about someone busting through the doors, someone saying to us, you can't do this. But we don't have to worry about how loud we get. We don't have to worry about what we say, think, or do in worship, because you paid the price for our freedom. We want to say thank you. Freedom gets really incredibly special when you have the opportunity I had last week to spend a little bit of time with a friend who is nameless, who serves in the Church of the Nazarene in a place that is nameless. And he described to me his worship service where he serves. He said, on Sunday morning when we come to worship the Lord, this is how we sing. And I said, really? He said, yeah, if they hear us, they'll kill us instantly. And I said, well, how does your pastor preach? He said, well, when we come in on Sunday morning, everybody gets a sheet of paper, and it has on it an outline. It doesn't say anything about God. It doesn't reference anything of Scripture. We have code words for everything. And here's how he preaches. He said he can't speak out loud because if he's heard, he'll be killed. I thank our veterans because this morning we can worship in spirit and truth. And you will never know how special you are to me. Thank you for your service this morning. Number of announcements I need to share quickly this morning. First of all, we're praying today for a couple of special churches. The Iglesia del Nazareno, Iglesia del Nazareno en Español over in Junction City, our Hispanic church there at J.C. Nass. We're also praying today for the Belmont Boulevard Christian Church here in town, that God would just bless their ministries and their efforts to reach the lost for Him. Just some incredible things that these churches are doing. We want to celebrate God's blessings in their midst. A couple of other announcements. Fun After 50, Friday evening at Coyote Canyon at 5:30. And I know it's not called Coyote Canyon anymore. The name has changed to protect the innocent. I don't know. Yeah, the innocent coyotes are no longer being challenged. They say they're changing their name and making their menu all new, so that could be kind of cool. But we're going to be there Friday night with Fun After 50. Man, we did not forget the Father's Day steak cook. We just ran out of time in June to pull it off. So our Father's Day annual steak cook for the men of the church is on July the 15th, a week from this coming Saturday at 6. Cost this year is $14. Those doggone cows cost a little bit more this year. But we want to invite you to come and be a part of that. Bring a friend, bring a family member, bring somebody who doesn't know the Lord and just come and enjoy a great evening of fellowship together. It's going to be a great time. The next 2 weeks, we're going to be blessed to have Melissa Harvey home with us from Japan. And next Sunday, she's going to be serving enchiladas for lunch right after Sunday school and then into the afternoon. So if you're interested in purchasing enchiladas, the fundraiser that she does every year, she will have enchiladas for purchase. I accidentally erased my email about that. So if you call the office tomorrow, or we'll send an email out. That'll be better one, Don, because Don has the email that I erased. And we'll get information out. If we don't have your email address and you are interested in buying enchiladas to help support Melissa's ministry, please make certain you either call or stick your email address in the offering plate when it's passed a little bit later. Those going to junior high camp, registration's due July 14th, and we need your money for that, team, so we appreciate you getting that in as quickly as possible. Tonight, we're going to do something a little different than what we normally do on Sunday night. This last Wednesday, our Bible study met, adult Bible study met with the teens, and they were able to watch one of the services from General Assembly. And what I'm going to do tonight is share with you probably one of the most significant events that happens every 4 years at General Assembly, and it's called the Quadrennial Address of the General Superintendents. For those of you who are new to the church or those who've been in the church forever, it's just an incredible vision of who and what the Church of the Nazarene is, what we're all about, what God is doing through the church around the world, and what it looks like to be Nazarene. We're going to start that a little after 6 tonight. We're going to be here in the sanctuary rather than over in the fellowship hall. And I would just invite you to come. It's kind of a long thing. It'll take about an hour. But I think it will be well worth the time to come and hear the message from Dr. Busick and just hear what you have been a part of over the last 4 years around the world. Because we are not just a church in Salina, Kansas. We were a part of a church literally around the world. Now, John, I have to confess, we're pretty light on attendance today compared to last Sunday.
Yeah, well, we were.
Yeah, the room that we broadcast to you from last Sunday had 25,000 people worshiping, and the room right next to it, it was the overflow, had another 15,000, 40,000 Nazarenes last Sunday. Let me tell you, when you're with that many people who love the Lord, it's kind of raucous. The music was great, it was just wonderful. So think about how we could get 40,000 here, it would be great. We would just love to do that and celebrate a little bit. One of the incredible events that happened last week at General Assembly was the International Quiz. This was the first time that I am aware of at World Quiz where rather than just including the kids who speak English, they brought kids in literally from all the corners of the world. And in one section, they set up translation booths, and kids had headphones to hear the questions in their own language and to be able to quiz. Now, that's pretty cool because for the first time, we've always called it World Quiz, but it was only the United States. These kids this year got to go to World Quiz, and they did amazing. We have 5 kids that are come up, and Tom and Beth are going to share a little bit with you of what happened and how incredibly cool this week was. We have a few things for you to do.
Wow, we got to see some of the photographs that Solomon posted of their quiz. That room was packed. I think they had 4,000 blue quizzers and 1,200 blue quizzers. And all these kids are blue quizzers, so they had 2 rounds of 20 questions. And Kayla, is red quizzer. They had how many red quizzers? 800?
I think they had 800, yeah.
Can you imagine 800 quizzers all together? It's amazing. Anyway, we have some awards to present to them because they did such a good job. We have gold awards, and 3 of the kids got gold awards, and 2 of them got silver. So that's quite the accomplishment because you have to practice your verses and remember all the different questions that we have. So Cole and John, why don't you come up here and I'll give you your medals here. These are gold medals.
Tom got the boys and I got the girls, so Sakandra is aging out of children's quiz, but she still got to go this year, and she got a gold medal as well. And Kayla is a red level quizzer. Are you first, second grade? You were second grade this year? Yes, but she was second grade this year, so she can go again in 4 years. She'll be sixth grade. So that is really special. And Kelly is fourth grade, and she's a red level, blue level quizzer too. So we've got medals for them. And you know these kids that got red level, or they got silver medals, was only one question less than they would have gotten a gold medal. So they all did excellent jobs.
Tom and Beth, the church really loves and supports the ministry that you do with our kids. Hiding the Word of God in people's hearts is an amazing thing. And because we don't want to run the risk that you might think your day is done, we have a little gift for you. This is all the quiz material for next year. And you know, because we don't want to run the risk that you guys may escape, okay, for the Amaro girls, here's a set for you. And for John, here's a set for you to take home. You don't get anything because you're leaving. And there's your set. And what this is all the stuff they need to be perfect quizzers next year.
Yes.
Okay?
Yes.
So it's everything. Quizzing is as much about the parents as it is the kids, because if mom and dad don't help force kids to study, and sometimes you have to force them, they don't quite wind up at this level. So we have some quiz parents in the house. I want you to stand, and we want to say thank you to you as well for the work you've done. Fun thing from last week. You've heard the adventures of Pastor John, Pastor James, and Pastor John Miller, who had the incredible audacious times of working in crazy places, wrecking a church bus, doing all kinds of cool stuff. So John, come and share with us what all happened last week.
All right, well, Sydney. We also had Georgian with us, but Georgian is in Arizona. He just loves to travel. So when he got back from Indianapolis, he took off to Arizona. So I'm going to quickly go through some of these. You guys speak up, grab the mic. So you can. Oh, give a retired pastor a mic. That could be dangerous.
We heard that.
We heard that last Sunday.
Giving a current pastor a mic is dangerous.
Yeah, you can't take yours away. So. All right, this is just our opening session, and you can tell we're a little exhausted from traveling. We left at 3:30 the 18th on Father's Day, 3:30 in the morning, and drove. And we're still smiling and happy.
And clean.
enlarged into a poster that he has put in his office so that it's there to greet her when she comes to work.
This is one of the projects. We had two houses that we were supposed to work on. There was a total of 21 people on our team that left from Salina and ended up all the way from Japan. Our team members were all over the place. But we ended up with 21 people, so they gave us two homes to work on. I don't have a lot of pictures of this house.
We only painted the front porch, John.
Oh, the front porch is all you painted on that. We have a lot of before and after pictures. So this is before, and then this is after, when Georgian got done cleaning, cleaned out that whole side. And then another, this is before the bus got hit.
Isn't that pretty?
And this is after the bus got hit. Don't try to take on a semi, you will lose. Even if you're in the right. Doesn't matter. This is Gene's trailer. Thank you, Gene. this is the bus. It takes a lot of force to do that to a rim. But nobody was injured on the bus. That is good. It does, however, have a little wind noise now. If you drive down the road with that door open. And this happened several times after my mic's off. How about now?
There.
I hear myself bounce off the back wall, so I thought I was on. This happens quite a bit, or happened quite a bit, and when the mirror flips over like that, you can't see the right side of the bus. And it happened to me one time while I was driving with no one else in the bus, and I needed to get over in the right-hand lane. That's kind of scary. Just kind of go. Hopefully nobody's over there, because you can't see.
But that's the side that people can see was hit, so they get out of the way.
It was the mirror's fault.
That's right, it's the mirror's fault. This is kind of the before, some more before pictures. This was the second house that we worked on. This was the main house that this team worked on. And then it was the kitchen. Our job was to clean off her kitchen. And work on her back ramp. So we'll quickly skip through some of these. They gave us 12-foot, 5/8-inch sheetrock to put up on the ceiling. That's like professional sheetrockers, which none of us were professional sheetrockers. And if you haven't picked up 5/8-inch sheetrock that's 12-foot long, it's really heavy.
But first we got to carry it around the house, out the back door, around the house, in the front door, through the house, to the kitchen, and then put it on the ceiling.
Yeah, because this was... Where it was probably 5 feet from the kitchen, but we couldn't make the corner with 12 foot, so we had to go all the way around the house and do a spell. More ceiling work, more deck work. The kitchen, this is all her kitchen. Georgia taking a break. There's that. And then they also gave us 12-foot-long, 3/8-inch sheetrock, which is not very heavy, but it breaks very easily. Because it bends. So that was another challenge that we had. It rained on Thursday?
Friday.
But, oh my goodness, I have not been in the rain like that for a long time. It was curb deep all over town. One lane of traffic was pretty much underwater. All over Indianapolis. And when you have 21 people that are working in a small kitchen, and it rains, you have no place to put people. There's just, so we get a little close.
They call those frog stranglers in that part.
That's right.
Yeah.
We did this a lot. We just looked up and watched John work. Georgian, he's helping us quite a bit. Looking up again. James is trying to work. This was Cindy's usual pose. No, actually, Cindy did a ton of work. She was our painting chief and let us know when we didn't do things right.
At both houses.
At both houses, yes. Just more of the crew. This was how her walls looked when we got there.
Before.
Before we got there, yes.
Don't be afraid to ask us to dinner.
did a lot. He's in a lot of these pictures because he was all over the place. Was a great representation of Salina teens. We'll zip through. And then John didn't cut a lot of sheetrock except on the heart pieces. And then said, okay, John, come get this figured out. You come out and show us how we did it wrong and fix it. Usually fixed our mistakes. And Cliff, I thought of you all week because I kept saying, Mud will fix that. Mud fixes everything. With Cliff, sheetrock. That's his answer. Oh, Mud will fix that. I can fix that. So John was like, yeah. Sometimes they painted more than the things they were supposed to. That's an arm. But it says, can't read the armband, but it says project, I can't read it either, but it's got the zip code. And what One Heart Many Hands did was they did about 100 projects in one zip code in the city of Indianapolis. And so we have One Heart Many Hands vans from all over the United States working in the same zip code. So you pass them. It always honked at you if they passed you as you're out there. Kind of encouraging.
It happened many times every day. There'd be a Nazarene van from some place would drive past and see our Nazarene bus, and they would honk and wave, and we would honk and wave and use all of our fingers, and it was fun.
Yeah, it's nice.
You'll notice. I think it was the Shepherd Project.
The Shepherd Project? They helped us, yes. All of her doors, windows had that nice rounded corner on them. So cutting out sheetrock was kind of a pain. We'd take lunch breaks on our porch. Georgian would find things in the backyard that he wanted to give to lunch, I guess. I don't know. We had a surprise visitor. John showed up. I think this was Georgian's getaway car. I'm not sure. Looked for a way to get out of there.
That's the same tree line that Georgian deforested.
That's right, yeah. I can't go back, so that's right. And then we have some of the after. Now they had services pretty much every night we were there. The four of us didn't actually get to go to any of those because we couldn't get back done with our project in time. Because when you're sheetrocking, you got to get it mudded and it's got to dry, and you got to do another coat and it's got to dry. So by the time we would get back and have dinner and shower, the service was about over. But Melissa was in. I don't know if you can't really tell, but at the end of that picture, it looks like a little narrow strip. This sidewalk was like that. It was covered in grass all the way up, so we cleared that all out. This was the front porch ramp that really went nowhere, but we restained it because it would come down, and then there was probably another, what, 3 or 4 feet of drop to get to the sidewalk.
The end of that concrete pad is right there at the picture, and then it's a big hill. This lady is wheelchair-bound, so she can't use it anymore, but it does look a lot prettier.
Yes. She could get off the porch if she wanted to. This was the back ramp that we did. More sheetrock pictures. There's the house that's finished with the other group. You can't see the stair tread, but we did stair treads and painted. And then we missed Dwight because those cords, that was her wiring. She needed outlets on the other side of her house, and so she had extension cords all over her kitchen. And she made sure that we put them back so that she had wire. So, since she was in a wheelchair, she asked us to put that cabinet lower so she could have access to it. And the new kitchen cabinets, I waited all week because I was hoping that somebody else would rip out the cabinet. But everybody else kept finding jobs to do. And so finally, I ended up having to go down and check cat. And under the sink, it was rough. You saw it earlier with Mask. Yeah, I was down there. They were laughing at me because I got a clean piece of sheetrock to kind of lay on. But and then once I got that all done, then I had all kinds of people that were willing to put the cabinets back in. Thank you.
put a window in.
Yeah, we did put a window in. Throughout the day or the week, she was constantly giving us pointers on things that we needed to do better. And we thought we were done, and as said, we were at the van leaving when she starts screaming, and we go back, and she couldn't get her door shut because they put expanding foam in it, and it it made it too hard for her to shut. So John's like, I can fix that. Comes back with his hammer and some nails, and now she can do it. We were literally at the van thinking we were done, and oh no, she had more for us to do. I think these are the final.
It's a new front door we put in.
New front door and a new back door. This back door used to be a 30-inch door. It's now a 36-inch door. She could barely make it through with her wheelchair in a 30-inch door. She had to hit it exactly. And then that was the final crew. Cindy took this picture. That's why she's not in it. That was at about 7:30 Saturday night.
And, and that's with the light on.
Yeah. So thank you guys for your support and helping us make this trip possible. We did, as a team, we purchased a washing machine for the house that got painted. She had been going to the laundromat for over 30 years, had never had a washing machine. And when they read her reports, they found that she had the washing machine hookups in her porch. And so we went and bought a washing machine for her and delivered that. She was pretty surprised when we showed up with that. And then Jean, the house that we worked at, her gas stove was 20-some years old. And since we had used it somewhat for a stepladder at times, the top kind of broke. And so she was like, oh, it'll be fine.
It was rusted.
It was rusted before.
Both sides of it.
We made sure that it was gone after standing on it. So we got her a new stove. So she was pretty overjoyed. And that was just from the members of our team who pitched in and put together and got those items. So thank you again for all of your support.
It's the first Sunday of the month, and we have kids in the house. So kids, we're going to do something, start something new on the first Sunday, and I'm going to have you all come up. We're going to do a little quick children's sermon. And parents, if you know anything about me, this is the thing that I'm more scared of than anything I do in ministry. I'm scared to death of children. Always have been, always will be. So kids, come sit right up here, please. You gotta sit where you can see me, okay? When I pastored in Kentucky, I had a beautiful lady in the church by the name of Jan Greathouse, and every Sunday, Miss Jan would do children's sermons for me. I would give her my sermon on Wednesday, and she would write a new sermon for children. She would say this isn't gonna work, and she'd make up a sermon that would work. And she would have the kids come up every Sunday, and we just had a great time together. And I love kids, I'm just scared to death of you, okay? Because you're just scary, you know? I can deal with adults, you know, they ask questions I usually can find an answer for, but you guys ask questions like, why? Why? I don't have those answers. But you know what, I want to ask you a question today. Why do you think I have this fan up here on Sundays? Why do I have it up here? You nailed it. Yeah, we're going to blame the lights. The truth is I'm a little overweight, and my blood sugar gets a little crazy, and I sweat, and I get really hot. And if I had my way, we would have the air conditioning at 60 degrees in here. But the people out there don't like that. I don't know why. But you're right. I have the fan up here every Sunday, and we turn it on. Now, Pastor John's also gotten to like it because he turns it on before I do usually on Sunday. Because he won't tell it quite as honestly as I will, but he gets hot too. He just doesn't show it the way I do. But you know, one of the things that frustrates me about the fan, I never know where the air's blowing. Because you know what? If I turn it on, can you see the air? Well, how come? Air is invisible. You're right. You're absolutely. It's there. It's there, but we can't see it. But what happens if Pastor John does something crazy, like put a little streamer, if I can get my fingers to work, on the fan and turns it on? Now I know where the air's going. So when I set it back down on the floor, I can tell exactly, oh, that feels so good. That is so cool. Well, you know what? There's something really interesting in the Bible that is kind of one of those things that's hard to understand. Because in the Bible, there is this word that's used over and over, and the word in the Greek language is the word pneuma. Can you say pneuma? Now, pneuma is spelled really weird. It doesn't look like pneuma because it's P-N-E-U-M-A. We might say it's pneuma, but it's actually pneuma. The P is silent. And that word means breath or wind. And whenever that word is used in the Bible, guess who it talks about? It does. It talks about God, the Holy Spirit. And so when we read in the Bible about the pneuma, we read about the breath or the wind of God. Now here's the reality. We can't see God, can we? But he makes his presence known. And on the day of Pentecost, the Bible says in Acts chapter 2 that when the Holy Spirit came, there was this sound of a rushing mighty wind. And everybody knew that God was there. Now the amazing thing is, as you continue reading in the Bible and the New Testament about what the Holy Spirit does when he comes into your life, it says where God is present, where the Holy Spirit is present, you can tell he's there. So if God is in your life, I should be able to tell that he's there. Because he makes his presence known. Now, can I see your hand for just a minute? Do you see God in there? I don't see God there. But the Bible tells me that God's in there. How do I know that God, the Holy Spirit, is in there? Anybody got a guess? He's in your blood. He's everywhere in you. You know what the book of Galatians, Paul's letter to the church in Galatia, says about how we know when God's in our lives? You know what it says? It says that we're loving and that we're joyful and that we have peace and that we're patient and we're kind and we're good and we're gentle and we're self-controlled. And so when the wind of the Spirit blows into our lives, he makes his presence known by the way we live our lives. So when you're loving, it's a reflection of the fact that God is in you. When you have joy, it's a reflection of the fact that God's in you. When you have peace, when you're going through tough times and you just feel like everything's going to be okay, that's a reflection that God is in you. When you're hanging out with people who aren't always nice, but you choose to be kind, that's a reflection that God is in you. When mom and dad say, you know, you need to do this, and you choose to obey, that's a reflection that God is in you. And this morning, we're going to talk about the Holy Spirit when I preach in the service a little bit later. And the one thing that I want you to know for sure this morning is that the goal that God has for all of us is that his presence in us would shine in the world around us. So that when people look at you, they would say, Connor, there's something different about you. Could it be that God's in you? And this morning, the one thing I want you to take home with you when you go is this thought. I want to make sure that I show Jesus everywhere I go by the way that I live my life. Can you do that? All right. Go find mom and dad and have a great time with the rest of church.
You'll stand and we'll continue on with our worship.
Oh,
be seated.
You know, we did a children's sermon this morning, and there was one child in the house that just, I don't know why she didn't come up. I don't know why. So I'm going to make Caitlin go get her. Oh, the baby. Good, thank you. We always celebrate babies in the house, don't we? I love babies. I was teaching yesterday out in Plainville, Kansas, and our pastor out there, Nick, and his wife, Kylie Jo, have a precious little baby girl, and she was a part of our group the whole day, and that precious little girl, she likes to make noise. About halfway through the day, a couple of the board members were there, and it's kind of like they're looking at the baby, and I finally couldn't resist any longer, and I said, you know, when I'm in church and somebody starts snoring, I want someone to just go up and give them a Gibbs head slap and wake them up. When some adult's sitting back there talking, I want to just go stick a sock in their mouth. When a teenager's on their cell phone, I think I lost my cell phone. Is it up there somewhere?
Yeah.
It's up there. Cool. When a teenager's back there texting, I want to get their phone and throw it into the brick wall. But I said, you know, when a baby cries, I just want to jump up and down for joy. Because you know what babies represent when they make those little noises in church? They represent our future. It means that our church has tomorrow. A couple of weeks ago, on June 19th at 6:30 in the evening, after about 73 days of labor, at least that's how Mercedes felt, Mercedes and Tyler got to welcome into the world at 5 pounds, 14 ounces, 18 and a half inches long, little Ember Anna Marie Schultz. And this is her, and I'm glad Caitlin's holding her because I'm still a little shaky. Juice, thank you. And a second one of those too. We're really good. Thanks, Michaela. But Caitlin gets to show off Ember. She is such a precious little girl. She has changed the lives of Tyler and Mercedes again. Number two is a little bit more challenging than number one because number two wakes up number one, and then you have two making noise. But there is little Ember, and we just want to celebrate her life this morning. If you would be mindful to pray for this precious little girl and her mom and dad and her brother and just ask that God would continue to bless. Would you just say amen this morning?
Amen.
Amen. Thank you. And when Caitlin gets done, she has to return the baby. But you might take a hint of what you're holding in your arms because I could be a grandpa again. Wouldn't mind at all. Always room for more. We're going to go to the Lord in prayer this morning, and as we prepare to go to the Lord in prayer, we're going to do something really out of the ordinary. Can you tell I'm switching things up a little bit today? I'm going to ask all of our veterans who are in the house today to come forward, and if you can kneel at an altar, I'd like you to kneel at an altar. If you can't, I'd like you to sit here on a pew. And what I would love to have you do is come forward and represent the memories of those who you left behind, because I know some of you left battle buddies and dear friends on the field of conflict. But I also want you to represent for our church today the countless numbers of men and women who are serving today in harm's way for us. And as we go to prayer this morning, I just want you to stand in their stead. To be here is a constant visual reminder to us of how important it is to pray for the people who continue to serve to keep us free. I'm not only going to ask the veterans to do that, I'm also going to ask the police officers and fire workers, anybody who's involved in keeping us free, caring for our needs. I want you to come forward this morning and just be a part of our prayer time. Now, I also need to share with you a really urgent prayer request. Bill and Lila Arnold have been of our church, part of our church family. Come on forward. Bill and Lila have been an incredible part of our church family for a number of years now. And Lila has been going through a significant number of tests lately, a lot of health issues, trying to figure out what's going on. And this week, the doctor shared with her that they have discovered a tumor on her pancreas. And she is going to be scheduling soon surgery for that. Pancreatic tumors are very difficult tumors. And as you can imagine, as Lila shared with me this morning, it's a frightening time. But I also know that Lila is a woman of faith because she said, "Pastor, I want to be prayed over." Book of James tells us, if any among you is sick, let him come before the elders of the church, be anointed with oil and prayed over, recognizing that the effectual fervent prayer of the righteous has incredible power, and we believe in a God who heals. Amen? Amen. So this morning, Bill and Lila, I'm going to ask you to come down, and if you could kneel here, if you can at the altar, if not, just sit here right on the front row. And we're going to ask those who would to come and gather in with Bill and Lila this morning. And as we prepare to go to the Lord in prayer, as we sing a song and we celebrate God's blessings and goodness, let me just ask you to enter and join with us as we come before the Lord this morning.
Yeah.
this morning in your presence so incredibly thankful for your amazing grace. That grace that sought us when we were at our worst, that drew us and offered us forgiveness and hope and healing, that enables us to stand before you, God, clean, not because of anything that we have done, but because your love and your grace is so sufficient. And for that this morning, we say thank you. God, we gather today as a people who truly know in Christ what it means to be free. Free from sin and its power and its dominion. Free from the guilt and the wrath that comes with condemnation. Free to enjoy hope, forgiveness, and peace with God. The joy that comes in worship. And that freedom came, Lord, because you were willing to stand in our stead and make it possible for us today to know healing and grace and forgiveness for sin's dark blot in our lives. And for that we say thank you. But on this Independence weekend, we also celebrate another freedom. A freedom that comes to us as a gift through your hands, through men and women who over the last 250 years have dared to stand in harm's way for us. Some went as volunteers, some went as a part of a conscription, some went just because they knew it was the right thing to do. Regardless of how they got there, they served. Most came home. Some did not. But all said the price of freedom was worth whatever price they had to pay. And this morning here at this altar and in this sanctuary are men and women who have served faithfully and well. And God, I thank you for them. From the simplest joys that I have of being able to worship freely, to enjoy life in a nation where there's freedom, where I don't have to live looking over my shoulder or wondering what comes next because they paid the price. God, I thank you for them. And this morning at this altar, they represent those incredible numbers of men and women that stand still in our place in harm's way. Some serve on outposts in very dangerous quarters. Some are stationed on bases or in ships or forward operating bases. Some are stationed stateside. Some are stationed in peacekeeping forces. Some serve on bases around the world, but all of them are ready at a moment's notice to fight for freedom. This morning, through these veterans in this sanctuary, we'll lift up those who are currently serving and ask, Lord, that you would protect them. And that, God, you would somehow communicate into their hearts the over a million strong in our armed forces, who today we lift to you and ask that you would bless them. We also thank, Lord, of those in our church family who serve in law enforcement to protect the peace. Pray especially this morning that you would bless Charlie and you would bless Jeremiah as every day they strap on their equipment and they go out into harm's way in our neighborhoods to help us be safe. And I just pray, God, you would protect them and keep them and use them and remind us through them how important it is to be faithful. Abide and bond and armor in a world that is filled with too much of the exact opposite. Lord, all of us have needs this morning, and there is one huge need that is before us right now. And I just want to ask, God, this morning that you would be with Bill and with Lila. These have been really, really tough days. Lila's gone through a lot in her journey, from a brain tumor and other health issues. You have brought her through much. But now the doctors are saying there is much more to go through. The good news is, Lord, you tell us in the book of Isaiah, the 53rd chapter and the 6th verse, that by the stripes of our Lord there's healing. That Jesus, what you endured before, during, and after the cross was for not just our spiritual good, but for our physical good as well. And today you are Jehovah Rapha, the Lord, our healer, who offers us to us health and wholeness in ways that we could never imagine. And this morning we just want to commit Lila to you, her situation and all that is going on with it. And this morning, in obedience to your word, she comes before the elders of the church and she asks that she would be anointed with oil representative of the Holy Spirit for healing. And today I just pray that you would touch her and that, God, you would bless her in a very special way, as only you can. Well, we know what the doctors and the medical community have said. We know what the tests read. We understand those things. But the one thing not found on those paper or written in the hand of man is the fact that she serves the living God, who is able to do immeasurably more than we could ever ask or imagine. And so today we pray for healing for her body. God, we pray that you would arrest those cancer cells, and then right now, in the name of Jesus, you would bind them by his precious blood and drive them from her body. And that, God, you would do a work so complete and so entire that it would absolutely astound not just the doctors and nurses, but the entire community, because you are a faithful God. Nevertheless, we commit her to your will, and we say, God, we want what you want for Lila. And so today, in bringing her before you, we simply say, Lord, we want your will to be done, and we trust you, God, for a good outcome. Father, I pray you'd be with Bill as well today. I know what it is to struggle with a spouse who's suffering with sometimes what we call life and death issues. I've been there. And I just pray that you would envelop him with your love and with your care and let him know, God, today that you're with him. And that his bride is in the greatest of the great's hands, because she's in your hands, Lord. Father, we covenant to pray with them and to continue praying, not just for their needs, but all of our needs, that we could trust you, God, to do amazing things in our lives, for which we give you praise. Lord, this morning is an act of worship. We say thank you for the way you've given to us. And now in worship, we choose to give back. In a moment after we have prayed, the ushers will come and we will give to you, Lord, our tithes which you command and our offerings which you gladly receive. I pray you would bless every gift and use it to the furthering of your kingdom in this place, in Jesus' name. And all God's people said,
Amen.
Thank you.
Sunday is that you get up to preach and it's 5 minutes before church is supposed to be out. Hey, that's good news. I was teaching yesterday over in Plainville, and the person who was supposed to teach with me was not able to go from Wichita, and when you have about 9 hours of lecture material to share, and you realize suddenly you're it, and you're going to stand and speak for 9 hours, and it's going to be fun. I have a little knack of being long-winded, and so Pastor John was praying for me. I know he always prays for me when I speak, and I'm sure he was thinking through the day that though it's supposed to be over at 5:45, it'll probably be 9 o'clock before he shuts up. And to my surprise and his, I was done at 5:50. It's kind of cool. I am not going to be done at 10:45. I really feel the Lord wants me to share with you a few things. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to cut out about half of what I was going to say, and we're going to take a fast ride today, okay?
It's preaching, you
know? I'm going to try. It is great to be back with you. I have to say this. There's this thought in the world today that to be effective in ministry, you can't preach more than 12 minutes in length. And it was really cool this last week to listen to 6 general superintendents preach, the shortest of which was 55 minutes. And he held us, they all held us in the palm of their hand. I don't know that I always accomplished that, but I'm not going to feel bad about going a couple minutes over, okay? Hear the word of the Lord this morning. Over the last few weeks, we have been talking, when I've been here, about the articles of faith in the Church of the Nazarene. Who we are and what we believe. I cannot tell you how proud I am of our church. We are a church united. Last Sunday morning, I worshiped with 40,000 people, not including what watched on the internet. The glimpse I gave you at the start of your service last week was just one of 2 rooms filled with thousands. There were 25,000 in the room that I gave you a look at last week. That's a lot of folks. And one of the things that one of our generals said that I absolutely loved, they said, you know, unlike all of the other Protestant religions in the world, we are not a collection of independent national churches that come together in a close association and unite saying, well, we're a part of the Church of the Nazarene. He said, we are the Church of the Nazarene. And this morning, while we're worshiping here, as he was talking, he said, your church is also worshiping in Papua New Guinea, in Johannesburg, South Africa, and Beijing, China, believe it or not. On the Ivory Coast of Africa, in Eastern Europe, and down in Australia and New Zealand, in South America, everywhere there are people called Nazarene, we are worshiping together. And so this morning, the coolest thing about coming to church for me is I came to church with 2.5 million members of the Church of the Nazarene today to worship one Lord, one faith, one God, one baptism, to celebrate Jesus. Amen? That is cool. And at the heart of who we are as a people are the articles of faith. And a few weeks ago, I shared with you the first article that talks about God and His Trinity and who He is and what we believe about God. And then 2 weeks ago, I talked to you about what we believe about Jesus Christ. And this morning, we're going to talk about what we believe about the Holy Spirit. Now, the coolest thing about the articles of faith is that our theologians, at least when the 16 articles of faith were written for this edition of the manual, they kept things pretty tight and pretty compact, so much so that I can actually get it, if I can get my phone to stay on so I can control it. I'll do that, and that'll make it work longer. We can actually get the whole article of faith on one slide. Isn't that cool? Now here's what it says. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the third person of the triune Godhead, that he is ever present and efficiently active in and with the Church of Christ, convincing the world of sin, regenerating those who repent and believe, sanctifying believers, and guiding into all truth as it is in Jesus. Now on the surface you say, well, I don't really know for sure all that means, but it sounds good. So what I'd like to do in the next few minutes, and we're going to go fast, if you have the outline that's found at Bible.com, it'd be good to follow along, or you can just follow here. All the scriptures are printed on the outline that you can get on your phone. I want to move really fast through an outline, though, and try to share with you what we believe about the Holy Spirit. We're going to address three questions. First of all, who is the Holy Spirit? Second of all, when does the Holy Spirit come? And third, what does the Holy Spirit do in the life of a believer? All those things are found in that simple article of faith. So let's begin here. Who is the Holy Spirit? Well, Scripture tells us that he is the third member of the Trinity. Matthew chapter 3, verses 16 and 17, an incredible passage of Scripture where Jesus has come before John the baptizer as he's baptizing in the Jordan Valley. And when John sees him, he recognizes the Lamb that comes to take away the sins of the world. He celebrates the fact that God is now incarnate in Christ, and he baptizes Jesus. Now, he said to Jesus first, I'm not the one that should be baptizing you. You should be baptizing me. And just said, stop. This is where my earthly ministry begins. I didn't say that, but that's what he was saying. And I must be baptized. And as John the Baptist lowered Jesus into the water and began to raise him, an incredible, incredible event happened. The Scripture tells us in Matthew 3, verse 16, that as soon as Jesus was baptized and came up out of the water, at that moment, the heavens opened. And he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and alighting on him, and a voice from heaven that said, this is my Son, whom I love. With him I am well pleased. Now you say, what does that have to do with the third member of the Trinity? It's real simple. Jesus, the second member, is being baptized. The Holy Spirit, the third member, comes and alights upon him. And Father, the first member of the Trinity, speaks, this is my beloved Son. Scripture confirms over and over and over and over that the Holy Spirit is in fact the Spirit of God, the Spirit of Jesus, one in three, communicating to us all that we need to know about the Father. The Scripture goes on to say that he is also the ever-present one. I love the way Jesus puts this in John's Gospel when he's sharing with us about the ministry of the Holy Spirit. In John chapter 14 and verse 16, Jesus says, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate, another helper, to help you and be with you forever. Now, folks, I want you to grab hold of that today. When God says through his Son to you and I that the Holy Spirit is coming and that when he comes, he will be with us forever, he means he will be with us forever. The Holy Spirit is the ever-present one. There is no place you can go to escape from his presence. He is there when we rise up, when we lay down, when we're in the good place, when we're in the bad. Wherever we are, the Holy Spirit is there with us. And that ought to bring comfort and encouragement and strength and hope to wherever you are, because he's there with you. We also understand in this passage from our manual that he is the efficiently active one. Now I'm going to confess to you, I hate theological terms. We were working on some of the issues of our doctrine this last week at General Assembly, and some of it got sent back to the Board of General Superintendents to fix, because they wrote it in words that couldn't be translated into other languages. There's a new language called Global English. Have you ever heard of Global English? I have not heard of Global English, so I had to go find out what it is. Global English is English where sentences are asked to be no more than 10, but absolutely no more than 15 words long. And they have to use words in global English that can be translated. Now, it's interesting, if you go back in some of the old Nazarene manuals, when we get to this part and this point that he is efficiently active, it says he is efficaciously active. Does anybody in the house know what efficacious means? Sounds like you got something stuck in your throat. So we changed and we said he is efficiently active. Now, I can define that. He does the right things at the right moment, at the right time, at the right place, in the right circumstance to take care of us, because that's efficient activity. And this morning, God the Holy Spirit is always present, always active, always seeking to lead, to guide, to direct us into a deeper, stronger relationship with the Father. And so when we say this morning that a part of who he is one who is efficiently active, what we're saying is he's here right now to meet you and minister to you at the point of your need. And when you walk out of here, he's going to be there too. Efficiently active all the time. Which brings me to a second question we asked this morning. When does the Holy Spirit come? Well, we read in Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 13. That when we were included in Christ, when we heard the message of truth, when we embraced the gospel of our salvation, when we believed, the scripture says we were marked with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit. The moment you and I invite Jesus Christ into our lives, the Holy Spirit comes in. He is the one who identifies to us that we have been heard when we ask the Lord to forgive us. He is the one who makes real to us the fact that our hearts have been cleansed and we have been set free from the dominion and the power of sin. He is the one who, when we say, Jesus, I believe, lets us know that our lives will now forever be different. On the day of Pentecost, that became very, very real. And in Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 4, we read the story of how when they travailed in prayer and waited just as Jesus had commanded them to, after 10 long days in a prayer room meeting, suddenly things changed. There was a sound of a rushing mighty wind. Kids, remember the wind we talked about this morning? Couldn't see it, couldn't experience it, couldn't recognize it was there until it happened. And then it was a roar in the house. Now, the scripture goes on to describe the coming of the Holy Spirit. There were cloven tongues as a fire, as the King James translates it. In other words, there was this manifestation of God's presence. And fire in scripture always represents cleansing. And so, in that moment when they said that supreme yes to God, the Holy Spirit came and transformed their lives forever. Received as a pledge of our future inheritance. When we give our hearts to Christ, the Holy Spirit comes in his fullness and enables us to live and to serve in obedience to the Lord. When we stop to say, Lord, I want you at the center of my life. Which brings me to the next question, what does the Holy Spirit do? Well, Jesus tells us, first of all, he convinces the world of sin and righteousness and judgment. John chapter 16 and verse 8, he says, when he comes, he'll prove the world to be in the wrong about sin and righteousness and judgment. About sin, because people do not believe in Christ. About righteousness, because Christ is going to the Father where you can see him no longer. And it's important to understand when Jesus says that, what he's saying is that God is going to give you the Holy Spirit because the visible, physical presence of Jesus will no longer be there for you to emulate. You see, the disciples had it really easy. They could see what it meant to follow Jesus because he was right there. When they saw him work, when they saw him minister, when they saw him heal, when they heard him teach, they knew exactly what it meant to be like Christ. But we read in Acts chapter 1 that Christ has now ascended to the right hand of the Father, and in his place the Holy Spirit has come. And so when Jesus says that about righteousness, because Christ is going to the Father where you see him no longer, what he's saying to us is, because you can no longer physically see me, I'll put my Spirit in you to reveal to you inwardly what it is to be like Christ. And about judgment, because the prince of this world now stands condemned. I think it's important for you and I to know this morning that at the heart of what the Holy Spirit does in us, in convincing the world of sin and righteousness and judgment, he communicates to us, if we'll dare to listen, that the prince of this world is a defeated foe. Satan has no power over you. He does not have a right to lead you astray. His kingdom has been shattered. Death has been defeated. Evil has been destroyed. And the only way it happens in your life is if you let him have his way. He's already been beaten, but you can give him permission to wreak havoc just by walking in disobedience to the Lord. Well, the Holy Spirit also does other things. The Word tells us here in this incredible article of faith that he regenerates, that he is the active agent in redeeming those who repent and believe. Romans chapter 8, verse 16 is one of my favorite verses. It's a simple verse. It says, the Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. And you say, Pastor John, why is that a favorite verse? Well, let me tell you why. Because when you give your heart to Christ, and you ask the Holy Spirit, ask the Lord Jesus to forgive you of your sins, it is the Holy Spirit who communicates to you that the business has been done. It's the Holy Spirit that fills you with that first flood of joy that we call forgiveness. It's the Holy Spirit that brings you that incredible joy that Paul calls joy unspeakable and full of glory. It's the Holy Spirit that communicates to you that peace that passes understanding. Because he is the active agent of God who regenerates and redeems and makes all things new in us. He also is the one who sanctifies believers, cleansing their hearts of the propensity or the desire to sin, and empowers them for life and for service. Acts chapter 1, we often read, we probably memorize, but it's so easy to pass over. But Jesus says there that you'll receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. The Greek word there is the word dunamis. It's the word from which we derive the word dynamite. It changes the way we read it, doesn't it? You will receive explosive ability, transformational power when the Holy Spirit comes on you. And that power is a power that comes to enable us to live and to proclaim his message of salvation to the world. Now, when we talk about sanctification, which is one of those church words that is often hard to understand and hard to figure out, Paul and the other disciples go on to share the story, and especially Peter and John, when they're pulled before the council in Acts chapter 15, because they kind of got off course. They did something terrible. They obeyed Jesus. They went out of Jerusalem and out of Judea and went into Samaria and began sharing the gospel. And the Gentiles suddenly heard the message of Christ and chose to believe. And when they believed, they surrendered themselves so totally and so completely that the Holy Spirit came into their lives in power and they were transformed. And when they stand before the council, they say, y'all need to understand something, that God, who knows the heart, shows that he accepted the Gentiles by giving the Holy Spirit to them, just as he did to us Jewish believers. And when the Holy Spirit came into their lives, something amazing happened. He purified their hearts by faith. Now, don't take lightly those words, because they're at the heart of what we call sanctification, where God the Holy Spirit, through a surrender of our wills to the Lord, comes in and purifies us of all sin. Not just the sins we've committed, but the power behind those sins that causes us to sin. God renders through the Holy Spirit powerless that propensity, that desire for evil. And he makes all things new. Now, I'll go on record this morning saying, apart from the ministry of the Holy Spirit, you cannot know that power. It is through the ministry of the Holy Spirit that you can be enabled to answer the call of God when he says, be holy as I am holy. Because in the moment you surrender full control of your life to the Holy Spirit, in that moment, he redirects your path. He switches off your tendency to yield to temptation. And he sets your eyes on a single path to give glory and honor to God through the way you live. It's the ministry of the Holy Spirit. But we also believe this morning that finally he guides and directs believers into all truth. John chapter 16, verse 13, the first part of that verse says that when he, the Holy Spirit, comes, the Spirit of truth, he will guide you into all truth. Now, folks, that's important because we live in a world that is filled with shifting standards. We live in a world where culture seems to establish what is right rather than truth and the Word. We live in a world where everything's up for grabs and everything is subjective. Had an incredible experience this week. We took a two-day little vacation on the end of General Assembly, and we ran over to the Cincinnati area, and we went to the Creation Museum and the Ark. You ever take a trip east, go there. Man, it was amazing. It's interesting, when you go into the Creation Museum, you get exposed to a lot of things. The views of science versus the views of the Bible. I'm one of those guys who believes that someday science will catch up with the Bible. They're just not there yet. They think they are, but they're not. And at the core of the whole ministry of creation science and the Creation Museum is this one thought. If we don't believe in the beginning God, nothing else matters. Hear me when I say that. Our salvation is dependent on the fact that in the beginning God. Because only the one who created it can call us to live a life worthy of his Son. Doesn't happen if we believe in a big bang. Who has authority to call you to anything there? Doesn't happen if you believe in evolution. Goodness gracious, we're all just a bunch of monkeys. But if you believe in the beginning God, all things are possible. Because you believed. And it is the Holy Spirit that brings us into that truth, that reveals to us what it means to follow Jesus. So let me ask one more question, and maybe try to answer it this morning as I close. Why is the Holy Spirit so important to us as believers? It, to me, is a real simple answer. John chapter 16, verse 13 says, when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he'll guide you into all truth, because he will not speak on his own. He will speak only what he hears, and he will tell you what is to come. He will glorify me, Jesus speaking, because it is from me that he will receive what he is to make known to you. All that belongs to the Father is mine. That is why I said the Spirit will receive from me what he makes known to you. We celebrate the fact that this is so important because the Holy Spirit makes everything we need to know about God available to us. Because Jesus shares it with him to give to us. What a truth. And on the heels of that, we're led to ask a simple question from Acts chapter 19, verse 2. Have you received the Spirit since you believed? Now, little nuance in theology I want to close with this morning because I think it's really, really important. Scripture tells us that when we come to faith in Christ, the Holy Spirit comes into our hearts as a pledge of the inheritance of His presence. We know that. So we know that at salvation, we get everything God has to give. His Holy Spirit comes into our lives, but not in fullness and not in power, because as of yet, when we come to new life in Christ, we really haven't surrendered everything. We've just said, God, I don't want to go to hell. It's the bottom line. Forgive me because I'm a sinner. And once we start living that life forgiven of our sins, suddenly we come to the place where we realize that there are some things that I know I shouldn't do that I just keep finding myself doing. There are things I wrestle with that I know I shouldn't wrestle with. And there are times that I know what is right, but boy, wrong is so much easier. And suddenly we find ourselves in the position where we say, what in the world is wrong with me? And God says, I gave you all of me. How about you give me all of you? This isn't about being saved, giving your life to Jesus and finding forgiveness of sin. This is about giving Him control of everything. Your plans, your dreams, your hopes, your futures, your life, your vocation, everything about you. To a point where you can say with absolute sincerity, not my will, but your will be done. So when they're asked in Acts chapter 19 and verse 2, have you received the Holy Spirit since you believed? The question isn't, are you saved? Do you know you're going to heaven? The question is, have you surrendered yourself so completely and so entirely to God that you can answer the call to be holy as He is holy and to live a victor over sin? So I close this morning with a simple question. For me and for all of you. Where is the Holy Spirit in your heart? We know what we believe, but beliefs are only as good as the paper they're printed on, which isn't much, unless those beliefs are turned into actions where lives are changed. Does the Holy Spirit have absolute right of way in you? Have you said to God, the Holy Spirit, I want to get out of the way. I want everything you have for me. Do you know what it is this morning to surrender completely to Him? I want to invite you to bow your heads and close your eyes, and I know we're late, but there's a question I want you to answer this morning. Not for me and not to me, but to Him, the Father above. Is the Holy Spirit in absolute control of your life right now? Can you say that beyond your salvation, you have trusted Him to cleanse you from all unrighteousness and to break the power of sin in you so that you can live a holy life as He's called you to? Have you said with every fiber of your being, God, I'm no longer in charge. You are not my will, but your will be done. This morning, as you sit in the sanctuary, or if you're listening on the internet, and you would have to say, you know, Pastor John, I just can't say that I have a positive answer to all those things. One of the beautiful things about the ministry of the Holy Spirit is He is efficiently active and present right now. And you can make an altar where you are, or you can stand up from where you are right now and make your way to an altar here in the sanctuary, and you can say, God, I want one thing. Everything you have to give and the power and ministry of the Holy Spirit. We're not going to wait long. We're not going to sing a song. I'm just going to be silent for a few moments and give you an opportunity to answer Him the question. As He looks at you and says, do I have your all? And if you have to say this morning you don't, I'm going to invite you to step out from where you are and make your way to an altar and surrender everything to Him. Mind the Lord. Father God, I thank you this morning for your word, and for the foundational beliefs upon which we base our faith in the church, and today for the ministry of the Holy Spirit. I still remember that moment on March the 3rd, 1981, when having been saved 2.5 years earlier, I heard the clarion call of God that said, you know, there's parts of you that you just haven't let go of. And if you'll give them to me, the Holy Spirit will empower you to live the life that I've called you to. And on that morning in March in 1981, I remember stepping out from an altar, from a pew, and going to an altar with a Nazarene evangelist on one side and my lead professor in college on the other. And they prayed me through to a place of absolute surrender. Father, I remember how excited I was when I got saved. And I remember the change that took place when I allowed your Holy Spirit to have absolute control. And I've never had to renegotiate. I've never had to look back because your Spirit's been there. And what is true for me, I pray would be true for all of my people and those who worship with us today on the internet. That God, we just get out of the way and say, Holy Spirit, be my guide. Holy Spirit, be my guide. And Lord, as you work, may the change that you wrought through your Holy Spirit in our hearts be so evident that as we shared with the children this morning, it would manifest through things like love and joy and peace and patience and goodness and gentleness and self-control, that we could be agents of change in a world that desperately needs change. Hear my cry. In Jesus' name. Amen. Thanks for worshiping with us this morning. Sunday school teachers, forgive me, you've got to work to get through your lesson now. We'll see you back at 6 o'clock tonight. Remember, we'll be showing an incredible message from General Assembly tonight at 6, here in the sanctuary, not over in the fellowship hall.